This is the first of 25 to 30 events that we're going to be putting on throughout the year. So we welcome you to our first Emergent Speaker Series event. I refuse to be a pawn for Whiteness. My name is Stephanie Smith. I'm the program coordinator in the center. And our department provides integrative educational experiences for student, faculty, and staff that facilitate critical conversations around sociocultural identity development, social justice, and the interplay between power and identity. And I'd like to encourage everyone to please grab one of our calendars on the way out, grab any flyers for any events you might be interested in. And you can also get in touch with us on social media. In the back of the room, you'll see the board. You can get with us on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, and also email. You can sign up for our email list and get regular updates on the events that are coming up as well. And we also have the physical space in the first floor of this building. You can sign on 105. We have a bunch of computer terminals and space there for you guys, so we encourage you to please come in and take up the space. It is your student space, and come and reclaim that space. So now I'd like to introduce Dr. Nicholas Hartlep. He is currently Assistant Professor of Educational Foundations at Illinois State University. Previously, he was an Advanced Opportunity Program Fellow at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and Urban 13 University, where he earned his Ph.D. in the Social Foundations of Urban Education. He is also a former public school teacher and has taught in Minnesota, Wisconsin, and abroad. He is also the author with works including The Model Minority Stereotype, Demystifying Asian American Success, and co-editor of Unhooking from Whiteness, The Key to Dismantling Racism in the United States. Dr. Hartlep's interest in counseling and transracial adoptive family dynamics stems from the fact that he was adopted from Seoul, Korea when he was approximately 13 months old. And finally, I'd also like to invite everyone to Dr. Hartlep's second event tomorrow, which will be in this room from 11:20 a.m. to 12:50, reading the Model Minority Stereotype. So please feel free to join us again tomorrow for our second event. And please welcome me in joining Dr. Hartlep to DePaul University.
Before I begin, I just want to say thank you for being here, because no one likes giving talks to an empty auditorium or classroom. I'd like to thank Sarah, the director, as well as Stephanie for hosting me today to talk about topics that I find extremely valuable and important professionally, but also personally. As Stephanie mentioned in the introduction, that I am an adopted individual. So the title of my talk with you today is I Refuse to be a Pawn for Whiteness. And I'm going to move around because I've heard people say they hate hearing a lecture, they want to see a lecture. So I'm going to engage with you, hopefully, in ways that will allow you to be participatory. There'll be a dialogue as opposed to a monologue and, you know, and a Q&A. So I will keep some time at the end for a Q&A more formally, but if there's anything that you want to interject, feel free. I hate to talk at you. So I begin with, you know, a pawn. There's this play on a game that I'm trying to talk with you here, right? Chess. Any chess players in the room? Should I show hands? People dabble with that? Well, chess is a game played with two opponents, right? Opposite sides of a board, 64 squares, alternating colors. Each player has 16 pieces, right? There's the king, queen, rook, bishop, knights, and the pawns. Now, the title of my talk, I Refuse to be a Pawn, right? There's eight pawns. And it's the most numerous of all the pieces, right? There's the most pawns. There's just numerically a lot of pawns in the game of chess. But there's also this idea, excuse me, about the pawn being weak and or less important, meaning, right, you can give up a pawn in your strategy when you play chess. Right? You wouldn't want to give up your king, your queen, and your rook, and your bishop, and your knight, because they play a more pivotal role. Right? Perhaps. I'm also getting at the idea of I refuse to be a pawn for whiteness, and the idea of we're not being used. And the we can be all people, right? Because whiteness doesn't just hurt people of color, it hurts white people as well. And Mari Matsuda, in 1990, she encouraged Asian Americans to stop being used, air quote, and to instead form interracial coalitions and alliances to fight white supremacy. Now, this was published in a law review article, and Mari Matsuda, being Asian American and female, I believe offers us a perspective that is important to consider when talking about whiteness, the model minority stereotype, and today's remarks that I'm making. Now, according to Matsuda, the role of the model minority is a critical one, okay? It can reinforce white supremacy if the model minority, right, the individual, deludes itself into thinking that he or she can be just like white if he or she tries hard enough, right? Trying hard effort is this idea of meritocracy, conformity, assimilation. Conversely, the model minority, that individual, can dismantle white supremacy if he or she refuses to be a model minority. If it refuses to buy into racial hierarchy, if it refuses to abandon communities of black and brown people, choosing instead to form alliances with them. Now, this might be hard to understand initially, this slide, but I'm going to unpack it for us today, okay? First question, I think we need to ask ourselves if we're being used, all people, but especially and specifically Asian Americans. Are Asians being used? And I want to talk about three things today with you. Affirmative action, what I'm calling political ploys, and Teach for America. Has anyone heard of Teach for America? Maybe have family members or acquaintances who have been Teach for America core members? Okay, I saw some hands up. The first is affirmative action or negative action, right? And so when we think of affirmative action specifically in the context of higher education and mission, there are some people, there's many camps, but let's, for sake of discussion today, let's say there's two camps. One, that are supporters of affirmative action, they're pro-affirmative action, they endorse it, and they're groups that oppose it, reject it, they're anti-affirmative action, right? Negative action is the idea that, right, if a university denies admission to an Asian American who had been admitted had that person been white. Now, affirmative action, this debate is very sensitive, and it seems like it's always receiving attention, right? There's many great books on this that actually say that the largest recipients of affirmative action are white women. And we can have a discussion of why that could be, or why that is true, towards the end of today's talk. But let's talk about how Asians are used in this debate. Well, if Asians are highly successful, or they are thought to be, or perceived to be, or misperceived to be, then they may not be eligible for affirmative action, right? There are many states and universities and policies that prevent Asians from accessing affirmative action. Now, Stephanie mentioned in the introductory remarks of my biography, I was an Advanced Opportunity Program Fellow. AOP is an affirmative action program, so I have benefited from affirmative action as an Asian American. Another consideration we have to think about and discuss is are Asian Americans or Asians in the United States people of color? And certainly I would say they are. And so one way that Asians are used as pawns in the affirmative action debate is twofold. One, they're deemed highly successful, so they don't need to access these programs and support systems. And second, they're deracialized in that they're not minorities, but clearly Asian Americans are minorities, and they should be thought of as minorities, and also minoritized. Here's a political ploy. Anyone see what I have here on the slide and could offer me a suggestion of why I'm calling this a political ploy? That's a real URL, harvardnotfair.org. Who is represented in this image? Asian American, yeah, East Asian American, right? Because race is socially constructed. We're not colorblind. Well, some of us are. You can't see green and red and purple. But in terms of racial colorblindness, it doesn't exist, right? We see race. I see all of your races. And so we could suspect that she is East Asian. So what other things are going on in this website? This is a screenshot of the landing page of this website. Be brave. I can't do all the work this morning. I know it's early. Anyone just shout out.
Who do you think this ad is talking to? Who's the you? Like, who's the person who's supposed to be looking at this going, were you denied admission? Who's the you?
Minority.
A what?
Minority.
A minority? What do you mean, like a... So one possibility, right, is that it's targeting people of color, Asians, or African Americans. Any other possibilities?
As the opposite, I would say white people that didn't get accepted, and then trying to see Asians in this negative manner for thinking this, they always get in, they're always smart, they have all these other things.
Also could be possibility. I'm not really sure.
Absolutely. I think it's a combination of both of your remarks. Thanks for being brave and sharing your thoughts. I think you're both onto something. Why I'm thinking it's a political ploy is, one, you have to think of the institution itself, right? Harvard has prestige, right? If you go to Harvard, that is capital. And certainly by plastering this young lady's face here, and then this whole notion of you're denied, like, hey, Asians, they're taking over these spots, right? A historically white institution, right, who benefits from legacy admissions, etc., right, is fearful, right? And that is part of a yellow peril, right, this idea of fear. So I mentioned affirmative action, a political ploy, and Teach for America initiative. I asked if some of you have heard of Teach for America, and some of you indicated yes. For those who are unaware of what TFA is, that's what we call it for short, Teach for America is a program in which students who graduate from a college or university participate in the core, they call it Teach for America core, and they teach. Now, some people call Teach for America the acronym standing for Teach for a While. And Teach for a While because it is often and frequently used as a resume builder, that someone graduates from an elite college or university, goes and teaches for a while in an urban school system or district, and then they go on to law school or medical school or what have you. It's almost deemed a, you know, service. And that's problematic for a variety of reasons. One, they have not gone formally to school to study to become a teacher. So myself, I studied traditionally for 4 years, right, in a Bachelor of Science to teach. I took courses on pedagogy, curriculum instruction, class management, etc. So I felt that I was prepared. These TFAers, on the other hand, may have been a biology major or something unrelated to the education field. And so they're underprepared. Another problem with the TFA, right, is that if they teach for a while, there's this revolving door, right? Teachers come in, they leave. They come in, and they don't really buy into and devote their careers for children, right? And a lot of research shows that that leads to poor academic outcomes, right? Because students need to see that their teachers care for them and they're from the community, etc. So why would I say a Teach for America initiative? Well, recently, TFA launched an Asian and Pacific Islander initiative, right? And according to TFA's thought and perspective, they believe by recruiting, training, and placing Asian Pacific Island teachers into underserved schools, they're confident that the challenges that Asian American students, right, K-12 students we're speaking of, the challenges they face can be met more effectively. Now that may be true, that may be untrue. But I want to point a few things. I've already said, right, that Teach for America are alums of elite universities. Now that's not always true, certainly you don't have to, but there is this trend that appears to be to indicate that the core members tend to be graduates of elite universities. I know it's small here, but this is the ethnic and racial diversity of the 2011 Teach for America core. And you can see that 6% in 2011, 3 years ago, 6% of the TFA core members were Asian. Now that doesn't mean a hill of beans to most of you. But it says something to me as someone who studies education. Let's look at this. I know this is 2010 data, but let's, for sake of argument, say that it's very current, and I think it is fairly current. This is K-12 students in the United States by race and gender. Asian males and females, you can see on the right-hand column the percentages, 2.17 and 2.09% respectively of male and female students. Asian Americans are the fastest ethnic racial group in the U.S., very fast growing. Percentage-wise, around 2% of the K-12 students. Now, the teachers, now this isn't TFA data, this is nationally, right? 1.8% and 0.45% of teachers. Now, as an Asian American teacher, I can tell you, in all the time while I taught, I only came across one other Asian American male. He was a middle school teacher. I was a first and second grade teacher. So we are very underrepresented, especially I was early childhood, elementary. Right? So Asian Americans, underrepresented. TFA, they have 6%, right? You know, certainly it's important to give more Asian American teachers, as these statistics show. But I often question the motivation of TFA for why they're doing these programs. And we'll circle back. And it's linked to whiteness and the model minority theory. Okay, I began today's discussion by mentioning pawns, most numerous chess piece, also, for all intents and purposes, the most weakest. Asian Americans are currently the fastest growing ethno-racial group in the United States. That's power when you think about it. Because who can vote, who will become more representative, hopefully, right? So even though pawns are weak, or as I'm calling Asian Americans, perhaps politically or socially, they're a fast-growing population. That's something we can capitalize on, and we as an Asian American. And when we think about other issues like voting, voting blocks, marketing, Asian Americans comprise a large block of money. So you see stores advertising to them, specifically like Walmart and Target. They're understanding that they're a capital market in which we need to give our time and attention to. But if Asian Americans are weak, it affords us an opportunity of making coalitions, right? I showed the slide about Mari Matsuda. She said, right, Asians can be used as pawns, which is why they need to establish inter-ethnic, inter-racial, interfaith alliances. Now, what am I talking about? This talk, the title is coming from a chapter in the book Unhooking from Whiteness, and I'll read a few quotes from it in a moment that will really kind of bring this together. First, I believe, right, that we need to think of what this quote is saying. And this quote, I think, is very powerful. It says, by passively accepting the privileges of whiteness, Asian Americans have become complicit in America's present system of hierarchy. What the hell does that mean? Let me tell you what Nicholas thinks it means, and then I can hear from you what you think it means. It means this, among other things. If, as Asian people, supposedly we benefit from a positive stereotype, and if you don't know what the model minority stereotype is, it's a stereotype that really restricts Asian Americans. It says they're doing well in school. It also has certain stereotypes of women, Asian women, right? That they're sexualized, you know, and that can be seen, you know, in the adult entertainment industry, genres of adult entertainment on the objectification and sexualization of Asian women's bodies. It also is emasculating of Asian men, right? That they're nerds, they're very passive, they're good technicians. They can never lead a Fortune 500, though. They have these mathematical and scientific skills, right? But they lack the soft skills. They can't get it done like the other CEOs, right? I think that if Asians buy into this, and on some level, it would make sense because they say, hey, look, I'd rather be applauded for being hardworking, et cetera, rather than being called fill in the blank, right? I'd rather be thought of as a model minority rather than some other stereotype. But if stereotypes are wrong, if it's wrong to stereotype black people as NFL athletes, right? You know, grew up in Green Bay, and it's fascinating. It's a very white community. Green Bay Packers are very, might be treasonous because we're in the midst, I'm sure, of a lot of Chicago fans after the game, but I'll say it anyways. A lot of white kids growing up would say, you know, I would be with them like, oh, there's a Packers, and it would be a black guy. They're like, well, why do you say it's a NFL player, right? Because he's a black guy? I mean, it could just be a normal person that's not an NFL star. So if it's wrong and problematic to stereotype black men as athletes or black women as welfare queens, then certainly it's wrong and morally questionable to racialize all Asians as being successful. There's an epigraph that I'd like to read
Howard in 1999 says, "In our lack of awareness, we can become mere pawns of dominance, perpetuating the legitimizing myths that have kept whites in control for centuries. If we do not understand dominance, we cannot hope to transcend it." Or as Chang in the same year, 1999, says, "To the extent that Asian Americans accept the model minority myth, we are complicit in the oppression of other racial minorities and poor whites. The model minority stereotype triangulates people of color and whites. And it does so this way." This is the work of Jean Claire Kim, and she has really coined this notion of racial triangulation. And how racial triangulation works is there's a triangle: Asian Americans, blacks, African Americans, and whites. Clearly, right, we see that whites are on top, superior, inferior blacks, but Asians are middlemen. They're in this middle area. Well, how does racial triangulation work? We have to think about race in America. And race in America operates under a black-white binary, right? But binaries, too, you know, well, where does this triangle, where's this third leg coming from? Well, it's coming from this idea that Asians are less advantaged than whites, but more advantaged than blacks. Well, how are they advantaged? Well, some people have called it honorary whiteness. They're honorary whites, right? You're not one of us, but you're better than the other group, right? People of Asian descent are looked at as being less American than blacks. You know, I see there are some Asian Americans in the classroom, and I'm sure if I was a betting person, I would hedge my bets that at some point someone has asked them, "So where are you from? Where are you really from?" "Born and raised in Chicago." "But where are you really from?" You know, and there's a comical skit on YouTube. "What kind of Asian are you from?" I really encourage you to look that down. I know some of you are taking notes. And YouTube, look for, "What kind of Asian are you from?" And this parody and this comical exchange, there's a white jogger and a Korean jogger. And the white jogger asks the Korean lady, "So where are you from?" She's like, "Fresno." "No, where are you really from?" "Well, Fresno." He's like, "But where are your people from?" "Oh, you're talking about my parents. They lived in Korea and they came to the U.S." And then she flips it over on him. "So where are you from?" He says, "Fresno." "But where are you really from?" "Fresno, America." And right, it's getting at this, "So you're Native American?" So that is part of being a forever foreigner, right, in this land. We're aliens in our own land. Right? You might be a third generation Japanese American, but you're still getting looked and questioned, right? So that's why they're seen as less American. And thirdly, Asian Americans are threatening. They're threatening to whites as a yellow peril, and to blacks and others, perhaps Latinos, as a model minority. So hold on to this threatening piece. Here you go. They're threatening. If they're taking over these historically and predominantly white institutions, what could happen, right? What could happen? Okay. Context. When did the stereotype begin? Well, it began in the 60s, 1966 in particular, in January. William Peterson, a sociologist at Berkeley, wrote this Times, New York Times magazine titled "Success Story, Japanese American Style." Now, we need to back up 1 second to talk about the context. A year before, almost to the month, in 65, Daniel Patrick Moynihan wrote a piece, a report, the case, the Negro Family, the Case for National Action. And in this report, He was a secretary, assistant secretary of labor. He wrote, talked all about pathologies of black families. Said, you know, they have a ghetto culture, etc., etc. Really demonizing black families. Right? So that began. In the wake of his report, Peterson wrote this story that applauded Japanese Americans for having good family values, being hardworking, etc. Well, it's really important. Did you know something about the Peterson fellow who wrote it? He had no working background on this. He was writing on the topic, and he had no preparation, no experience. He was commissioned by the Times, New York Times Magazine to write this report. And Daryl Hamamoto, a scholar, has written about that, of saying, look, you know, it was a political act. It was intentional that we wrote this. Because in the 60s, right, we were undergoing a lot of civil rights protesting, and it was a perfect time. Now, any of you born in the 80s? Anyone in the 80s? Few. Oh, the rest born in the 90s? Okay. So
Or earlier.
Yeah. So this is, you know, I'm a young guy, so this is around my time. And, you know, I say this in all seriousness. The fellow right here, I have like a young elementary photo. That looked like me. I mean, I was like, so where did my good looks and charm go? I don't know. But here you have in the 80s, popular media showcasing this extraordinary achievement of Asians, right? Got Stanford, all these subtle clues and not so subtle clues, right? During this time, the media was really drawing attention to Asians in America who were receiving these really prestigious science awards, Westinghouse Talent Search Award. And I'm going to say that in the 80s, right, that this was one of the high points of, and not in a good way, but in a high point of media really perpetuating the modern minority stereotype. Because shortly thereafter, in the 90s, we saw an attitude really change, right? That became more negative, more opposed. And you see that even into the middle of the 80s, into the 90s, right? Japan bashing. In 82, Vincent Chin in Detroit was murdered. You may have heard that case of in Detroit, in the Motor City, because, you know, the automobile industry, Asian car manufacturers were beating America car industry, and there was a lot of resentment. And so Vincent Chin is really a poster child for mistaken identity, but he was beat to death with a bat by two white guys. And so that's kind of seeing that, you know, being modern minorities can really flip in a flash of a moment, right? You can be on the high side, arguably, and then all of a sudden you're looked at as a threat. Now, I ask this question, I know there's a lot of text here. Is it possible that the media gravitated toward reporting on Asian American Science Awards during the mid-1980s because the stories were convenient and provided headlines that would sell? Maybe. Well, I don't have empirical evidence. I think it's also possible that the media drew attention to successful Asians because the stories fed the current propaganda for why Asian Americans are to be feared. And a lot, there's cases of this where Asian scientists were accused of espionage, right? This whole idea that they're unpatriotic and that we need to keep them on a close chain because we're fearful of them. If there's one thing that I'm sure of, American journalism has been long proficient at, it's stoking fear, certainly. Right? There's an interesting article in which these researchers looked at these Westinghouse talent awards. And in the few decades prior, they found that from 42 to 58, most recipients were white, affluent men. Right? So how all of a sudden, just a few, 20 years later, all of a sudden Asians are taking over? Certainly we have to think in the 60s, there was changes in immigration, right, in which highly educated Asians were coming to America, which can skew some of our statistics. Now, the nexuses of the stereotype, the model minority, are that it's like a bikini. What it reveals is suggestive, but what it conceals is vital for its perpetuation. Whiteness is so hard to understand because it camouflages itself. It's like a chimera, right? It changes, it's a shapeshifter. And so I think of the bikini as the red, right? They're disciplined, they're studious, they're obedient. Underneath that bikini is a reality, and the reality is mental health issues, depression, poverty, unsuccessful Asian Americans, right? Racism, discrimination, prejudice. So I think of it in those terms. Now I'll get to how and why I refuse to be a pawn for whiteness, and then we can have a little more meaningful discussion. But what I'm getting at, and in this book, which was really the motivation for today's talk, is this book is a compilation of autoethnographic stories. I wrote about my personal life. And as an adopted person, and I'm really thankful of having a chance to talk to you, does anyone know someone who is adopted, have someone in their family that's adopted, or even is adopted themselves? Raise your hand if you have a connection somehow to adoption. Now think about the connection you have to adoption, and think of who's adopted, who's doing the adopting, and who's adopted. Is there any patterns? Do you think, what do you think those relationships are? Who tends to adopt? White, so that's race, so the white people. Are they poor people, do you think? Middle class and higher? Okay. Who has to do the adapting? The white, middle to upper class people adopt. Who adapts then? The child? And who's the child? Could be Asian, could be white too, could be. But do you think they're from a position of privilege, the person being adopted? No. I was adopted, I found my father maybe 3 or 4 years ago, my biological. I searched. Went to Korea, met him, etc. And I found out some of the facts of my case. My father was unmarried. He was poor and homeless. And there was a time, and I don't speak Korean fluently, I'm learning, but through interpretation, the interpreter relayed this message with me and said, look, Nicholas, your father had alcohol addiction, extreme violence, like anger, was uneducated and homeless. And there was a time when he was thinking, do I give up Nicholas, or Komoil, that's my Korean name, Komoil, do I give him up, or do I kill him? That entered his mind. And thankfully, he didn't kill me, he gave me up. So when we think of adoption and my experience in life, my autoethnography, my story, why I refuse to be a pawn for whiteness, adopted people, we, transracial especially, we occupy a very interesting sociological space. Because I was raised by white adoptive parents. And so I was socialized to be colorblind. There was a time when I subscribed to this idea of, well, I just treat everyone the same. I also saw the contradictions of what their liberalism and their progressivism, as they thought it was. I remember we had a cat, black cat. They called it black cat. It was a fat cat. It was a nice cat. But beyond black cat, black cat died, bless her heart. They called this cat Sambo. Yeah, yeah. So as a young man stepping away from my family, I started thinking, well, why the hell would you name your cat Sambo? That's very racist. Why? Right, and I start seeing these contradictions, right? And so as an adopted transracial adoptee, right, in college, as I'm studying and learning more about whiteness and racism and oppression and dominance, I said, look, I refuse to be used for this shit. What do I mean by that? Well, if I passively accept the privileges of whiteness, right, I'm complicit in America's present system of hierarchy, right? And I'll give you some concrete examples. And this is another book that we're editing, and it'll be out soon. In this book, we have chapters that really talk about Asian Americans who are actually complicit in perpetuating whiteness. They really firmly believe in the stereotype, and they use it for their own benefit, supposedly, but I'm going to argue that it doesn't benefit them. How can it? In my own life, you know, as a faculty member, there's a tenured international Chinese professor, and then myself. And I can see it in the behaviors of the department members that he is received differently than me. I'm unthreatened, you know, because I have these, you know, being raised in mainstream, you know, middle class family, that, you know, I don't exhibit things of difference, you know, different. But when they get to know me, they immediately are shocked and they say, you're not who I thought you were. Because I'm very outspoken whenever I see, you know, discrimination. And so I refuse to be a pawn for whiteness by speaking up and out. If I hear or if I witness, I call it out and I immediately act. I also, the fact that I'm here, I think is one, I mean, let's be honest. How many lectures have you gone to of Asian American who are critical race theorists or who are outwardly speaking out against oppression? If you do, let me know their name so I can talk with them.
Mia Mingus. But she hasn't come here yet.
Okay.
I watched her on YouTube.
Okay. We're out there. Thank you for the call for bringing us here. We're out here. So there's many things I do and I act in intentional ways. Because I don't want to be an honorary white. Let me read a few more quotes and then we'll kind of wrap it up and engage in more type of dialogue. I do not fall for the goodies, air quotes. Whiteness privileges me with as a model minority or as an honorary white. I refuse to be a pawn for whiteness because that is what I must do to be a freedom fighter. According to Cho in 1994, when we, in brackets, Asian Americans, refuse to play the role of the Uncle Tom or the upstanding model minority, we also deny, in bracket society, a valuable mouthpiece to be used to front for and exonerate a racist United States. Similarly, Cho in 1994 notes that Clarence Thomas personifies for black communities in this country what the model minority and its legacy does to working Asians. Malcolm X famously asked, what do you call a black man with a Ph.D.? He responded to his own question of an N-word, right? Whiteness wants me to be its pawn so it can divide and conquer people of color. My choice is resistance through a rejection and refutation of the passive, quiet, and sullen Asian American. As Howard in 1999 noted, and I've already read his quote, in our lack of awareness, we can become mere pawns of dominance, perpetuating and legitimizing myths that have kept whites in control for centuries. If we do not understand dominance, we cannot hope to transcend it. So if you take away something that I've said today, and I'd love to hear your thoughts, if if you take away one thing from today's talk, I want you to think about the model minority stereotype as triangulation. It triangulates people of color, whites, and Asians, but interesting enough, right, Asians are people of color. And that if we highlight Asian success, it causes a divide and conquer among us. So the takeaway is racial triangulation really is a divide and conquer strategy. And that me as an adopted person, I speak up and out against racism and whiteness specifically by pointing out all of these internal contradictions, right? The model minority stereotype is fuel for policies that are ineffective. Because what it says is this, look y'all, they're successful, so why can't you do it? That is not the question we need to be asking ourselves, right? The question we need to be asking ourselves as people of color, why are we bickering amongst one another and fighting against one another when white supremacy and institutionalized and even legalized forms of racism go on unquestioned? And so until we start asking critical questions about systems, interlocking systems of oppression, institutionalized oppression, we really can't have true freedom. And so I refuse to receive anything from people who say it's in my best interest when they're hating on my brothers and sisters, right? My black and brown brothers and sisters, my yellow sisters, right? That we have to have these coalitions. And what better time than now, right, to form coalitions? Now again, I noticed there's some white people in the audience. I'm not talking about white people are bad people. Hopefully you're developmentally at the stage now where you're starting to see that we're not talking about white people, we're talking about systems and attitudes and thought processes. And so I'd like to open it up for question and answer, and also hearing your thoughts about anything that I've shared, anything related, maybe something you're talking about in your course. So let's have that. Let's do that. Yes?
You mentioned that you were socialized to be colorblind. When did you realize that you were socialized to be colorblind?
That's a great question. I don't have an age per se, other than I would say in college. But ironically, you know, my K-12 experience, I'm a public school kid, that I had a very bad K-12 experience. Some of you may have had awesome experiences. That was not me. And so it was in the classroom when I started to just, you know, I was a sociologist, I said, in my classroom. I watched and witnessed the behaviors of my teachers, who were mostly white, and see the double standards they held, etc. So I became conscious then, but it wasn't until college, probably during my sophomore year as an undergrad. That's a great question, though.
How did you develop an ethnic identity?
That's a great question. I'm in the process still. But I would say that was during my Ph.D. studies. That was the moment when I had the bravery. And a lot of research talks about this, adopted people's identity when they do this. They're called trigger events. One trigger event for me, I was a young father, so I have three daughters now. But my first, Chloe, you know, when she was born, and I started to think, you know, what's my health history? Where do I come from? You know, and that motivated me to search for my father, which I found. It was a miracle that I found him. And so at that point, I began doing more socializing things, so really having more friends who are Korean. Going to Korean school, learning Korean, eating Korean food, right? Then prior to that, I would never have kimchi in my refrigerator. Now it's a must, you know. So it's just this music, listening to Korean music. I'm not just talking Gangnam Style. I'm talking, you know, K-pop and all of that. So it's a process, and I'm still there. And you know, you didn't ask for this, but I'll let you know. It's a very volatile process, especially for my partner, because you know she knew me, you know, in this process, and you know, I'm changing, right? And so I bring in baggage into these conversations that she didn't sign up for. But that the trigger event for me was having children. And I must say, I lost my sister. She's 35. She died this summer. And she was adopted. She was not biological, but she was adopted into the same family. And I knew, you know, it broke my heart. Obviously, her death is tragic, but also that she was beginning the process of thinking. She'd say, "Hey, Nick, you know, tell me about how did you find your dad? Like, I might be interested in doing the same thing." So she has never, she won't have that opportunity like I did. These are great questions. Any other or comments? You don't have to ask questions. Any comments about this or things you disagree with I've said? We can have those conversations too. It's not always you have to agree with the speaker. Did you know that? You have a right to push back? Yeah. maybe I'm telling your professor's not going to like me. but a safe space. Does anyone have any thoughts about it in their own stories? Anyone else adopted that feels comfortable enough to share?
Well, I asked because my mom is adopted from Thailand.
Oh, really? Okay.
So, into my grandparents are white, so I just was wondering how that happened because as a family, we've been going through that and trying to find that out.
Your mother is adopted and your father, is he white?
Yes.
Okay. You know, in the model minority research, there's a lot, I think, more attention, and I'm trying to spark it nationally, is that we need to think about multiracial and biracial. So you're biracial, you know, but socially, you could pass as being white. Like, I would never have thought that. I would encourage your mother, I don't know her age, but she's much older. Locating your parents or your biological parents is more difficult when it was old, you know, because I'm a younger guy, it was easier for me. In fact, my caseworker says, you know, you're in that window of time when it became easier. If you were born maybe 4 years, you know, older, then you would have a hard time because of record keeping in various countries, etc. But I would encourage your mother, if she wants to find, to reach out to her the organization which facilitated her adoption. For me, it was Children's Home Family, and they're based in St. Paul. In St. Paul, Minnesota, there's a lot of Korean adoptees. I'm not sure what state or what organization you're from.
My grandparents are missionaries, so
and
that's very random. So.
Yeah, but that's a starting point, you know. And through this process, it's been very challenging. Like, I've had to file Freedom of Information requests for my paperwork, because Homeland Security and Immigration, INS, etc., they don't really want to share that information. And so the biggest success I've had is I haven't located my mother, but I found my, I got a fingerprint on my mother. That's the closest thing I have, because on a paperwork from the Freedom of Information Act, I have her fingerprint. That's the only thing I have from her. Now, you know, I say, well, why can't we just like a CSI fingerprint database thing, and it's a lot of bureaucracy. I guess they don't think that will happen, but I'm hopeful that I can find her. So I really encourage you. You should probably support your mom, and hopefully she can do that.
I have two things. One, I wonder if you can talk a little bit about. I think that one of the things about transracial adoption that goes on today is, like, it's also important to think about the larger international context in which transracial adoptions happen. So I would argue that it's not a coincidence that the U.S. was at war with Korea and then created, like, and also with Vietnam in, like, the 50s and 60s, a lot of havoc was created in Asia by the United States sort of imperial war machine, or whatever you want to call it, or at least this war that we were participants in. Fast forward, shockingly, there's a lot of children that are either orphaned, or their people are having a lot of trouble taking care of them because their countries are sort of chaotic. And then we have this situation in which, like, white Americans are encouraged to adopt those poor children that were just orphaned or semi-orphaned by wars in which we were fighting. So there's that thing is going on. So I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about, like, how you think about that. But also, I'm very interested in this concept of how, well, your relationship as an individual, like, how much can one individual do to sort of refuse whiteness, and how do you blow that up into larger structures? Because individuals, like, we can only do so much, right? We have our own spheres of influence. And so, like, how do you think about that notion of, like, yourself as an individual and what your sphere of influence as opposed to, like, other structural things that need to happen in order for this whole situation to change?
So your first question, I agree wholeheartedly with everything you said. I view international adoption as a form of human trafficking, because privileged people essentially pay for and acquire children who are minors and who had no say-so. And in fact, the policies really protect the anonymity and legal rights of the birthing, the parents per se, and the adoptee really is paid no mind or attention. Seen through the lens, you're absolutely right, through an international lens, the adopting countries and their involvement in wars and civil unrest and what have you, that's certainly part of that larger equation. And so I feel wholeheartedly that it is a form of purchasing children. And also it's very interesting to note, when you look at research and statistics on which children are more desirable, the white child is the most desirable, and they cost the most money. And then beneath that is Asian kids, and then it's just following the racial hierarchy, right? Black and white. White is more desirable down to black. And if you can't really refute that. It's important for whiteness, I think, and to segue into it, I think we can use this example as a good teaching point. When I've talked about adoption at universities for conferences and programs, I show this video in which these actors, a black man and an Asian woman, are supposedly the adopted parents of a white child. And they're acting. And you play it and they talk about, well, we just felt so bad for her, you know, and we're more privileged, I'm a lawyer, and et cetera, et cetera. And the people in the audience are like, what the hell is happening? It caused so much cognitive dissonance. And they stop, we stop and we talk about it, and then they disclose that they're acting. And everyone's like, oh. And I think it's really telling, because it shows, right, the unawareness. And so in the video, there's another sequence, and it's true, it's not acting, of an adoptive family. They adopted a child from South America or Central America. And they're so happy, you know. And they said, you know what, let's send some money back to Jonathan's birth parents. I don't know if that's his name. And we'll send him, you know, $1,000 American, which is a lot of money, $1,000. And that's more than enough. They could build a house. And it's at that moment. What would be problematic with that situation, sending $1,000 to Jonathan's biological parents in South America or Central America?
If they had that $1,000, they might not have had to give him up for adoption.
Thank you. Thank you. And also, let's be honest. Typically, you don't just give, your friend $1,000. I mean, you wouldn't, right? I mean, maybe you would, but if you are, at least
talk with me after. You really wouldn't. But the fact that there's a power differential from the sending and receiving country of a baby really shows the unawareness. That family had no concept. Right? They're happy, they're content. You know, they may have had infertility problems, but they acquired a baby, they're happy, they got what they want. And that adoption is a very dynamic process. No one really wins in adoption. We want to maintain families, to keep families intact. That's always the best. If you can keep a family together and give them social support, educational support, economic support, that allows that family to better their situation. My father would not have had to give me up if he had a home. I know there's cultural taboos too in Korea. If you have children without being married, it's very taboo. If you're homeless, you're invisible, even more so than in America. Poverty in Korea is very invisible. And so, if his circumstances were better, I would be there. Your last question about the we're only an individual, etc. Unhooking from whiteness is parallel to this whole idea of race traitorship, in that white people, you can speak up and out. So if you hear a racist joke and you're a white person, you could say something really crazy and it will really, you could say something like, "What? Why did you just say that? You know, I'm a black person," or something like that really messes with someone. Then it leads to these discussions. So Noel Ignatoff, he's written on race traitorship, and this idea. I think that individually, there's a potential for disrupting these systems. And I'll give you a good example. When I was hired at Illinois State University, part of my hiring package was, They threw this money at me. Literally, they didn't throw money. They offered money. We don't throw money. Maybe if you know some wealthy people, they throw money around. But they offered me money and they said, "Look, you're a person of color. You're a targeted hire. We'll give you X amount of money that you can use for your research for the first 3 years. That'll get you through your third-year review for tenure." I said, "Wonderful. Sign me up." When I got to ISU, I found out that other faculty of color were never offered these resources. And I thought, that's strange. Why didn't you accept the money? And they're like, "What money?" I said, "The money that I got and you didn't get." Right? And then there's almost, at that moment, it was like, oh, this heated debate. Like, why did Nicholas get money? I didn't get money. And it is because of institutional racism, that the office that disseminates this money doesn't want a lot of people to know about it. Like, that's strange. That defeats the whole purpose, right? And so I think by having discussions about that at an individual level has helped institutionally. I mean, so this conversation, the dean and others now, we're having these conversations about equity. And so I think that, yes, while we're small, you know, we're individuals, I think there's a lot of hope, and I'm optimistic that by having these smaller conversations can lead to more macro change. And certainly, if it doesn't, you can at least die knowing you fought the good fight. So, probably not a good response.
No, that's good. That's good.
With your view on adoption right now, like trafficking almost, like what is your relationship with your adoptive parents?
Good question. I'm really have a really solid and healthy relationship with my biological father, or not my adoptive father. There's too many fathers here. Not so good relationship with my adoptive mother and stepfather. So another thing, another trigger event, going back to your question, was the divorce of my adoptive parents. So when I was 8 years of age, my adoptive parents, they separated. So that had a lasting impact on me because, right, I felt abandoned, right? I felt like Good Will Hunting. Anyone see Good Will Hunting? Where he's like crying? Like, I felt like I'm having this moment, right, that I did something wrong. And then they divorced. And so that has always been a tension in my relationship. So I'm kind of have an estranged relationship with my mother, not so healthy. So it's not ideal. It really isn't. But you know, when you look at, when people adopt, what are the first metrics they look at? They look at your income. So you do this background check, right? Okay, you're not a felon. How much money do you have? What's your college level of education? Then they come and interview you, and they do a home visit, etc. Are you a decent person? There really isn't, and I know things are changing, but there really isn't a lot, I would say, about mental health and also family structures. I would argue that just because you have a lot of money doesn't mean you're going to be a suitable family to adopt children, right? You need, right, because they're colorblind, right? That's the procedure manual in the 80s. The procedure manual is to be colorblind. Right? You can adopt a child from another country. Don't worry about language. Don't worry about culture. Just love them. Love is not enough, right? Love is not enough. And so that's partially probably why there are so this tension in my family. Now I have children, and so it's not ideal. I saw you. Did you have a hand up?
I was going to ask like the same exact question, so.
There you go.
Yes, sure.
Two birds with one stone. That awkward moment. Stephanie, how much time do we have? Is this time, or is there a little more time? We have more time. Okay, so let me ask you a question, because I can't do all the work here. Have any of you never heard of the model minority stereotype, by a show of hands? Formally, that term, that Asians are small. Okay.
Who hadn't heard of it before I had you read the article over the weekend?
Oh, okay. And then those who have heard it before, where did you hear it?
I took a history of TV in a media class, and they kind of talked about that. In the 60s, they did things with, they like staged racial discussions, but it was just like what they wanted people to hear. It wasn't, and that was portraying black people as the model minority, smart, studious, and not, you know, really digging into what the actual issues were. They were just saying what, you know.
Yes, sir.
Well, all of my close friends are multiracial, so when we get together, sometimes we have talks about society and what's going on in the city and how race is breaking down. And I've also worked with education organizations that break down by race. Like, I don't know if you've heard of Education Choice Illinois, but they really are trying to get together all of the minorities to break the education system in Chicago, which is really not doing too well. So they're trying to do that, and they talk about how Asians are represented, blacks are represented, Latinos, all of them. And that's really where I start talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, your comment reminded me too, the importance of disaggregation, that Asian Americans aren't this monolithic group. There are so many subgroups. Unfortunately, the face of Asian Americans tend to be more of an Eastern Asian rather than South Asians, right? Or even Southeast Asian. But it's socially constructed, you know. Black hair, eyes, almond-shaped eyes, skin color, you know, light to fair skin color. But it's super important to understand that, you know, Iranians, South Asians, Indians, Filipino, you know, Pacific Islanders, some would disagree with me, but that they are part of this larger umbrella. And that you're right, that education and policy doesn't serve everyone equitably or fairly. And that's why I think your comment really brings to mind these coalitions working together, and also white people as well as allies in this, because even though whites have white privilege, you certainly can assist in this work, especially education work. So, yeah, thank you for sharing. So going back to my question, you shared where you heard it. Why do you think, and what could be a possible explanation for Asians, really always having to really reassert our problems. I mean, I hate to say it, but Sam Macias, a professor, he's written a lot about this extensively, of this whole idea that as people of color, Asian Americans, really, we always have to fight for why we need these services. Whereas other minority groups or minoritized groups don't. You know, Asian, African American, Latino, Hispanic population, right? Case in point, the DREAM Act and really, you know, the impact. Asian Americans were so invisible. Why do you think that is? Yeah.
We don't hear about it. Like, the news chooses to broadcast what it wants to tell us. And if people are blind to, like, the reality of the situation, the things that Asian Americans are having issues with, we're not going to hear about it unless they're going to tell us about it. Like on the news, I constantly hear someone got shot here, someone got shot here, and it's constantly being put on Black Americans. So it's pushing that stereotype to the rest of the community, this negative stereotype that's bad. But I'm not hearing anything about Asians having issues, mental issues, or income and money issues. I don't hear it. So. For me personally, it's hard to even know what's going on if I can't access the information personally.
What are your fields of study? I'd like to hear some of your fields of study.
Sociology.
Okay, sociology. Is graduate school in your future?
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
What are some other majors in there?
Elementary education.
Okay, teaching?
Psychology.
Any medical people? For psychology. I just read a study that showed that physicians can be biased by the model minority stereotype, in that their patients are receiving less than adequate care. What do I mean by that? Well, cancer is the leading cause of death, and you know, at the young age of 50, you need to have something done, right? A colonoscopy for cancer. And that these researchers really show that there's disparate medical care being given to Asian Americans. That Asian Americans, despite dying from colon cancer and breast cancer and other cancers, are receiving less recommendations to do these preventative care. And these researchers are theorizing, or at least finding, that it's because there's a halo effect, that for some reason they're not recommending Asian American patients to go in and do these medical procedures. That story could be applied to all of your fields. So in the teaching classroom, right, we have disproportionate ELL and Black students in special education classrooms, right, over disproportionality in special education. The same could be true, that problem that I just said in the medical field could apply to the educational field. What happens if Asian students could benefit from accessing those special ed services or mental health services, but somehow there's this halo effect around them that, hey, look, they don't have problems. And the other field, sociology, well, your field, you talk a lot about problems, so that's great. And other fields, too. Are there any other fields present here? Like journalism? So you're all going to be a sociologist, a psychologist, or a teacher?
I'm a theater arts major.
Okay, yeah, let's talk about theater. Okay, so you got your SAG card, right? SAG card, Screen Actors Guild card, and you're going to be an actor. So what's wrong with the Asian folk in acting? Why don't we see a lot of Asian American actors in really authentic roles? Not to put you on the spot.
Well, there's just like, I don't really know why, but like, I don't think there's a lot of like plays or anything that are out there that supports, you know, the Asian American in a sense like that. It puts them in like a bigger role, because also there's a thing called like blind cat, like blind casting, that's also kind of like turn a blind eye to race and stuff like that. Then there are some people who don't do that, so they're like, well, these characters have to be specific characters.
Is blind casting where you read lines but you can't see who the person is, like behind the screen? I don't want to sound ignorant, I just don't know.
No, it's just more like, it doesn't matter what kind of race or someone's, whoever that person is, that they are able to, you know, act that role the best, kind of, in a sense like that. Instead of it just being like, well, yeah, that's what it is, typecasting. Where it's like,
So it's better that Tom Cruise do the Asian samurai movie than a Japanese person? Or it's better, you know what, you hear what I'm saying? That
yeah.
Yellowface, blackface exists, but yellowface does exist in cinema, right?
David Carradine.
Yeah, David Carradine. And what about, we talk about complicity. Would you agree or disagree, Asian American actors need to resist playing superficial roles that really reify and reinforce stereotypes of Asian, what it means to be Asian American? So, you know, a kung fu fighting thing, or even Transformers, that one actor in that, the comedian, he's a male, he does a lot, he's done Hangover and other movies. Does he know the show? Okay, so he does a lot of reinforcing of stereotypes, but is it
except that his role in Community, I would argue, is actually quite counter-hegemonic. It's like he plays, okay, yeah,
I'm unaware.
He's an Asian actor, but he's playing a Spanish teacher at a community college, and he's like obsessed with Mexican culture, and I think that they've set up that role. It's almost like the whole conceit of his role is to bust stereotypes of Asians. So he constantly is in situations where he does the opposite, like his mm-hmm. character does the opposite of what one would expect of him as an Asian. Mm-hmm. So that I think is interesting, but that's, you know, the writers. But yeah, that guy, I know that, I mean, that actor definitely has done a lot of other crazy shit.
I think of Better Luck Tomorrow TV movie, that's kind of similar though, where uh-huh. they do the reversal of stereotypes. Yeah, so I mean, acting theater, there's application there of who, you know, the fit of a role. So you're all going to be actors, sociologists, psychologists, or teachers.
Okay, well, I'm a film major, so it's kind of the same thing, but it's really interesting because in the beginning of cinema, there were a lot of like African American filmmakers making silent films, but the problem is there was a lot of, especially in cinema, there's a lot of like social race power involved in it. So a lot of the white filmmakers were involved with like theater networks. So people would start a filmmaking business because they owned a theater, and then they'd buy other theaters so they could show their films to more people. And so there were a lot of ethnic directors, but no one would see their movies because they only owned one theater and would eventually get bought out by like a company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's that historical element too, you know, Hollywood, and like you said, the genesis of movies and film in America.
And then eventually there were laws and how you, or not laws, but like specific rules on how you portrayed people of race. Like if you watch older films, like if you watch like The Little Rascals,
yeah.
There's like the one little black kid, and he is specifically portrayed in that way because there's like a rule that, you know, if you had an African American on film, they had to talk in a way that was African American.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's very essentialized.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, okay, so one, you were talking about how, like, this perception of guess, do you see this, the fact that this perception exists, do you see, or do you have you experienced how that might affect Asian Americans in their coalition building with other people of color? I guess I'm asking because I always tend to, so I'm in community psychology, and it means that I generally work with the communities around the issues that affect them. So I'm always going into a community, and currently in the States, and I'm from Canada, currently in the States, you know, the issues that are of interest to me are, you know, around education and then around like mass incarceration. So I end up going to communities that are like one, like I work a lot with Latino youth, and then two, around mass incarceration, I will, you know, end up working with a group that's made up of the majority, you know, black peoples. And so I guess like my question is like, I think I'm naive to think that they don't, that I'm like the enemy. It, that I'm okay, like that I can just walk into these groups and not acknowledge the privileges that I do have as an Asian American, like false or not, or like given to me or not, like not by choice, but, and then secondly, like what is my responsibility and what is my place in working with these groups, and am I naive to think that like I do have a place or responsibility in working with these groups, and then my other thing is like, so should I then be working with like Asian American groups around these issues, but like, you know, any Asian American groups that I know of aren't working on the issues that I'm interested in. So then I know that doesn't really sound like a question. So
I was trying to like the here, can you encapsulate that into some questions? I think one question you're asking is, do the stereotype or the model minority stereotype influence how you're received doing the work you do in the community?
Yes, and how that affects like coalition building, for me specifically going into these communities.
Yeah, I think that's a question when you look at Asian American studies, and that very much began with middle class Asian Americans. Many of the civil rights, you know, SNCC and others had this middle class element. And it's almost this question of speaking. Who do you speak for on behalf of whom? And, you know, do you have legitimacy and authenticity? And so you mentioned it. You said that the work you're doing, you're not finding other folks doing it. So I certainly think you should continue to do that work, because we do need that work to be done. I think it's important to have your foot somewhere, and maybe multiple places, but so if it's in the African American community or Latino community, if it's in the Asian community, Asian American community, so you do have some support in the work you do, because otherwise you're kind of just out there. And allegiance, so to speak, you know, when you think about your training as well as what you do and why you do it, I have a lot of my mentors are strong African American women. Through mentors, formal and informal, certainly in graduate school. Black woman encouraged me to do a master's, encouraged me to do a PhD, and my doctoral advisor was a black woman. So I think that helps you have a compass. And yes, I would say that stereotypes and the myth of the model minority certainly impacts how you're received, certainly, especially your gender. I mean, intersections, right? It's not just that you're Asian American or Asian, it's also that you're a woman, it's also that you're what age, it's also your sexual orientation. You know, I'm cisgender, heterosexual male, Christian. So I have Christian privilege, heterosexual privilege, cisgender privilege, have educational privilege. So I think that's really important to think. I don't think it's just that you're Asian per se. And certainly it may complicate matters, but I would also say that it probably is an advantage, because we need more Asian American females doing this critical work. So I attempted to answer your convoluted questions, but maybe they're unsatisfactory in my response.
I think it's I don't know that I asked like a great question like that you could formulate like a real answer to. I guess maybe more concretely, like, okay, so I'm going to meet with this group this week. They're called the Black Project. And so they are all Black activist groups. So, and I want to work with them for my dissertation. And I think one of the questions they're going to ask me is like, okay, so you're not Black, obviously. And so why is it that, or we want, like, why is it that you want to work with us? And what do you think that you can bring to us, considering that you're not going to understand the experiences that, or have gone through the same experiences as us? And, you know, like, I don't have a good answer.
Yeah, but it's not, I think what they're looking for, certainly, that's a fair question, right? It's like, you want our data, why? And I think historically it's been very predatory that people, researchers have researched on communities. So there's a historical mistrust. So by building trust and rapport and relationship, it's like, you're not gonna get their data and leave. I mean, so I think that they are legitimately concerned, how are you gonna report it? And I think you can, ameliorate those concerns by being proactive. This is the research study, this is my intent for it, you know, if you're gonna do articles with it. This is my commitment to the Black community, you know, and this is what I'm looking for now and in the future. And I think it sounds like, to me, you're a very authentic and sincere person. I don't think there's any ulterior motive, and I don't think that you'll have a problem there. It sounds like you're using it for the betterment of a lot of things. So.
Can I add something? I mean, you can also have a conversation with them about reciprocity. I mean, it's not often that PhD students for a dissertation, you are studying, you're doing data, and you're writing a book, and you're going off and getting like a job or whatever. But like, if you want to have a more radical stance towards that organization, maybe there's some way that they could use your data. Maybe there's some sharing or some reciprocity so that they don't just feel like they just get studied and then you leave. And that you have a more sort of like radical relationship to their work, as one suggestion.
Yeah, member checking is always important. So if you interview, give them their data so they can look at it again and trust. So, yeah.
So we're at 10:00. I wanted to thank Nicholas for the time with us this morning, and again, encourage anyone who'd like to come back tomorrow in your another program, back in this room tomorrow The program starts again at 11:20 in this room, and it's reading the model minority stereotype, so much more conversation about that. And then finally, if you would mind filling out the evaluation that was on your chair when you came in, that would be super great for us to know how effective our programming is for you. And I can grab those on the way out. Thank you for coming today.
Thank you.